opportunity to distribute the Christmas invites and the Christmas newspapers to some of the homes around the chapel. We need to put some more stickers on some of these newspapers, so that's another job that could be done after the service if you're wondering what to do. That's a way that you can help. And then for next Sunday, we've got the church lunch, and we'll need to have a lunch, we need food, so you need to sign up on the board at the back as to what you can bring for that. And then just to remind you about this week, we have the Puzzle Club again, that's happening every Monday, maybe just get along once in a while. We'll come along on Monday, bring someone with you, let someone know that says, I don't know what to do, I'm lonely or whatever, we'll bring them along to the Puzzle Club. That's every Monday, 10 till 12. And this week it's the growth groups meeting, so you'll be contacted separately about that. And finally, we have the latest December bulletin. This was emailed out this week. If you want a paper copy, there are copies on the table at the back.
Well, good to be back here with you at Hope Church. Let's come now to the Bible to hear God's word. Psalm number 138, which is, if you're following it in a real Bible, it's on page 441. 441, Psalm 138, a psalm of David. I will praise you, O Lord, with all my heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise. I will bow down towards your holy temple and will praise your name for your love and your faithfulness. For you have exalted above all things your name and your word. When I called, you answered me. You made me bold and stout-hearted. May all the kings of the earth praise you, O Lord, when they hear the words of your mouth. May they sing of the ways of the Lord, for the glory of the Lord is great. Though the Lord is on high, he looks upon the lowly, but the proud he knows from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against the anger of my foes. With your right hand, you save me. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hands. Well, this is the word of the Lord, and we thank him for it and bring ourselves to that word this morning. But next, we're going to sing a hymn that picks up something of the desire to praise the Lord for his greatness that we've read about. And the hymn begins, "Tell out my soul the greatness of the Lord. Unnumbered blessings give my spirit voice."
Tell out my soul the greatness of the Lord. Unnumbered blessings give my spirit voice. Tender to me the promise of his word.
seats. Well, let's pray together. Father, thank you for those reminders of how great you actually are. We find it so easy just to run our lives through and a daily routine and customary habits, but Lord, help us to take time out to think of you, to think about you, to meditate on you and your wonderful ways with us. Thank you that you are the Lord supreme. Thank you that before you every knee will bow and every tongue confess our Lord Jesus is Lord, to your glory, our Father. In the meantime, thank you for opening many of our eyes to see who this Jesus really is. Thank you for the joy of knowing through him our sins forgiven, our peace with you, our great God. Thank you for church. Thank you for the fellowship of your people. Thank you for ways in which we can encourage each other, support each other in the Christian race. Lord, you know how there are times that really get us down, that trouble us. And Lord, we thank you for one another. Thank you that we are not left on our own, but that we can be part of a family that is family indeed. We thank you for the freedoms we have in our country. We pray, Lord, they may be preserved to us, for we fear that freedom of speech is a delicate thing now. And we ask, Lord, in your mercy, that you will continue our freedoms that we may proclaim Christ far and wide. We pray for those, Lord, for whom that freedom is a very strange and rare, if not totally out the window. And Lord, we pray for many of your people who are suffering for their faith in the Lord Jesus. Stand with them, Lord, uphold them, give them the courage and the strength and the hope in Christ that is sure and steadfast. We think of the troubled countries of our world where war is rife. And again, Lord, we pray for your mercy upon suffering peoples. Lord, may your word shine through those awful times and give people the hope that they really need in our Lord Jesus. We thank you that we are a people of hope and that it is not an unstable hope, an uncertain hope, but we thank you it is solid, it is real. It will happen. It is what you have said, and you never lead us up the garden path. You always speak the truth, and we thank you for that. So help us to trust what you say to us from your word today, and may it do us good. May it inspire us. May it challenge us. Lord, speak to us as you see our needs, and help us in our responses to it. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's sing a hymn, Jesus, the name high over all, in hell or earth or sky, the one who sets the prisoners free.
Angels and men before it fall.
Just have a seat. Is that your time?
Malcolm remembered better than me. I told Malcolm I was going to come up and say something at this point. So, Victor, you're coming up next. So, just a reminder of our Christmas services. Have these invitation cards and also these evangelistic newspapers. So if you want to take these for family, neighbours, people in your street, if you want to leaflet some of the street, that's fine. Please take those and use those. But just to say this morning, later on after the Lord's Supper, whoever is free will go out and just try and distribute as many as we can around the homes around the chapel here. So. And what's left after that, we'll find another time to do it. But we'll get started on that today. But Victor, do you want to say about the youth plans?
Thank you. So for the next youth group session, which is going to be in 2 weeks' time, we are wanting to have an outing, a social outing, that particular weekend of the 15th of December. So we're wanting to gauge interest from the young people who are part of the youth group. Available, would like to join. Happy to also get ideas. So far, we've had things like bowling or ice skating, something of that nature. But we would also particularly need parental consent as well. So you want to give advance notice. We will definitely give out a form that your parents can sign and you can bring along with you. But please do speak to myself, Chica, Julian, if you are interested in being part of that social.
Sorry I can't join you for that, but I can't get parental permission. Yeah. We're going to come back now to God's Word, and we're going to look in the second book of Kings, chapter 11, and if you're reading from your Bibles, page 268. I was going to ask you if you know the name Jehosheba. But that's a bit unfair, because if somebody out of the blue asked me, I'd say no. She lived in the first half of the 9th century before Christ was born. So that's not far off 3,000 years ago, isn't it? She wasn't a Western European. She was a Middle Eastern. Her name's only mentioned in 2 verses in the entire Bible. And she's only remembered for one thing that she did in her life. And what was that? Well, should you have come across her name before, well done. But have you heard about her in connection with the arrival of the Son of God as a baby in Bethlehem? Now, you may, of course, by now be thinking, I'm off my trolley. You may, of course, be right. After all, what could one action by a hardly known individual back in 835 BC have to do with the festive season? Well, would you believe it? She is the lady who saved Christmas. Most of us are unlikely to know much about her life and time, so I've given you a little bit of background info on the back of this morning's outline. 100 years earlier, the nation of Israel had split in two, northern section retaining the name of Israel, the southern postage stamp size state was known as Judah. Somewhere down the line from then, a king of Judah called Jehoshaphat gave his son Jehoram in marriage to a daughter of King Ahab of Israel. Her name was Athaliah. She was an even nastier piece of work than her pa. Well, the prince of Judah she married, Jehoram, murdered all his brothers to secure the throne for himself. The Philistines murdered all his sons, apart from one, Ahaziah. But he didn't last long, as he got removed in the purge carried out by King Jehu of Israel. So his mum, Athaliah, grabbed the throne of Judah. trying to murder all her grandchildren in case one tried to pop her off. But she hadn't reckoned on the lady Jehosheba, a daughter of her late husband Jehoram, probably from another wife. And this lady Jehosheba was married to Jehoiada the priest. Oh, so simple, isn't it? Well, I hope that bit of background just gives a little help as we open our Bibles to 2 Kings chapter 11. When Athaliah, the mother of Ahaziah, saw that her son was dead, she proceeded to destroy the whole royal family. But Jehosheba, the daughter of King Jehoram and sister of Ahaziah, took Joash, son of Ahaziah, and stole him away from among the royal princes who were about to be murdered. She put him and his nurse in a bedroom to hide him from Athaliah, so he was not killed. He remained hidden with his nurse at the temple of the Lord for 6 years while Athaliah ruled the land. In the 7th year, Jehoiada sent for the commanders of units of 100, the Karites and the guards, and had them brought to him at the temple of the Lord. He made a covenant with them and put them under oath at the temple of the Lord. Then he showed them the king's son. He commanded them, saying, "This is what you are to do. You are in the 3 companies that are going on duty on the Sabbath, a third of you guarding the royal palace, a third at the sewer gate, and a third at the gate behind the guard, who take turns guarding the temple. And you who are in the other 2 companies that normally go off Sabbath duty are all to guard the temple for the king. Station yourselves round the king, each man with his weapon in his hand. Anyone who approaches your ranks must be put to death. Stay close to the king wherever he goes." The commanders of units of 100 did just as Jehoiada the priest ordered. Each one took his men, those who were going on duty on the Sabbath and those who were going off duty, and came to Jehoiada the priest. Then he gave the commanders the spears and shields that had belonged to King David and that were in the temple of the Lord. The guards, each with his weapon in his hand, stationed themselves round the king near the altar and the temple, from the south side to the north side of the temple. Jehoiada brought out the king's son and put the crown on him. He presented him with a copy of the covenant and proclaimed him king. They anointed him, and the people clapped their hands and shouted, "Long live the king!" When Athaliah heard the noise made by the guards and the people, she went to the people at the temple of the Lord. She looked, and there was the king standing by the pillar as the custom was. The officers and the trumpeters were beside the king, and all the people of the land were rejoicing and blowing trumpets. Then Athaliah tore her robes and called out, "Treason! Treason!" Jehoiada the priest ordered the commanders of units of 100 who were in charge of the troops, "Bring her out between the ranks and put to the sword anyone who follows her." For the priest had said, "She must not be put to death in the temple of the Lord." So they seized her as she reached the place where the horses enter the palace grounds, and there she was put to death. Jehoiada then made a covenant between the Lord and the king and people that they would be the Lord's people. He also made a covenant between the king and the people. All the people of the land went to the temple of Baal and tore it down. They smashed the altars and idols to pieces and killed Matan, the priest of Baal, in front of the altars. Then Jehoiada the priest posted guards at the temple of the Lord. He took with him the commanders of hundreds, the Karites, the guards, and all the people of the land, and together they brought the king down from the temple of the Lord and went into the palace, entering by way of the gate of the guards. The king then took his place on the royal throne. And all the people of the land rejoiced, and the city was quiet because Athaliah had been slain with the sword at the palace. Joash was 7 years old when he began his reign. Well, we give thanks for the Lord's word for us here this morning. We're going to sing another hymn during which the children will go to their groups. And the hymn is, "From Heaven You Came, Helpless Babe, Entered Our World, Your Glory Veiled." Well, as we come to God's word, let's pray. Father God, thank you that you are a speaking God. You don't leave us in the dark. Thank you for your word written, your word to us through your Holy Spirit. We simply ask, Lord, that you will speak to us here today, that we will not only be keen learners, but that we will be keen followers of our Lord Jesus. We pray it in his name. Amen. How does the New Testament kick off? Do you remember Matthew chapter 1? Begins with a long list, doesn't it, of Hebrew names that form a genealogy. It's a list of Jesus' ancestors, which I guess we tend to hurry over a bit. I rather like the story of the Bible translators who, while they were translating the New Testament into the language of a remote tribe in Papua New Guinea, decided those people would never cope with that list of Hebrew names in chapter 1 of Matthew. So they published a New Testament that began at verse 18 with the words, "This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about." They presented the finished work to the tribal chief, who said, Jesus can't be that important. There's no record of his ancestors. How does the list begin in Matthew chapter 1? Well, it starts by saying, this is the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David. And when things start getting moving in the narrative, we're told about an angel visiting the man to whom Jesus' mother was engaged to let him know what was going on and what he wasn't likely to believe if anybody else had told him. Sometimes truth is stranger than fiction, isn't it? And this is how the angel addresses Jesus' stepfather down in verse 20. "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife." Son of David again. Who on earth is this David? An angel turns up to announce what's going on to Mary, and Luke records him saying this about her son-to-be: "He will be great. He will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David." Ah, so this David was a king. King of Israel. Lived around 1,000 years before Jesus was born. He was their most famous king. And he's particularly important because God gave him and his dynasty some amazing promises. Like this one: "Your house and your kingdom will endure before me. Your throne will be established forever." David's son Solomon's prayer to God in 1 Kings chapter 8 includes these words: "Now, Lord, the God of Israel, keep for your servant David, my father, the promises you made to him when you said, you shall never fail to have a successor to sit before me on the throne." Now, the embarrassing thing about those promises from God is that they seemed fairly rapidly to go out the window. For David's dynasty only lasted for about 420 years. And Israel hasn't had a king of David's line for over 2,500 years. It looked as though God had reneged on his promises until we open our New Testament and learn that Jesus was and is the son of David. But he almost wasn't. And that's why we are in 2 Kings chapter 11. We might not have had to write all those Christmas cards. We might not have had to torment our body and soul by going to Blue Water. We might not have needed to obey Aunt Flo, the least family relative, a present and have her around on Christmas Day, oh dear. Or help keep the late Bernard Matthews turkey farms in business. Were it not for the Lady Jehosheba. There's a huge crisis, you see, in verses 1 to 3. There is an assassin at large. Queen Athaliah doesn't seem to be the sort of girl you'd want to date, actually. If the meal at the curry house you took her to wasn't to her liking, your head might be on the block along with that of the chef. She was power mad, it seems. Her son, King Ahaziah, had been popped off, but he'd left sons eligible to take the throne. And so Grandma Athaliah thought she'd better have her grandchildren popped off, so that they wouldn't be a threat to her ruling the land. And remember, all these sons and sons' sons and sons' sons' sons were all in the royal line of King David, to whom God had made a big promise about him and his dynasty. But Queen Athaliah had not reckoned with the Lady Jehosheba, who, as verse 2 tells us, stole young Joash away from among the royal princes who were about to be murdered. He was probably no more than a year old at the time, and so Jehosheba puts him and his nurse in a bedroom to hide him from Athaliah. And there he remained for up to 6 years while the usurper Athaliah ruled the land. It's a strange paradox there in verse 3. While an impostor rules the kingdom, the rightful king, the last remaining son of David's line, is in hiding. The true king is there behind the scenes, and the pretender doesn't have a clue about it. It's like that in the days of the early church a bit, you know. Paul says to the Christians at Philippi, all God's people here send you greetings, especially those who belong to Caesar's household. Now that Caesar at that time was the monster Nero. He the persecutor of Christians. But right there in his palace were people who belonged to a greater kingdom, the kingdom of God and of Christ, unknown, it seems, to Nero. It's so easy to judge what's going on simply from appearances, isn't it? The kingdom of God looked doomed when Queen Athaliah came to town, but God had his king in the wings. And he still does. The greater king than David and Joash secretly reigns at God's right hand, unrecognized by the pretenders of this age. And that should encourage those who are on his side, shouldn't it? Because one day the Athaliahs of this world will have had their day. And just like young Joash, Jesus will reign visibly. Universally. Well, Jehoshaphat had a husband who was a priest, and after 6 years of godless tyranny, he decided to put a plan together to rid the nation of its evil, illegitimate queen. It was a far better plan than the cunning ones that Baldric used to come up with in the 1980s, but it was highly dangerous. Jehoiada the priest was a courageous man, risking his life for the sake of God's kingdom. It would be his head or Athaliah's when the plan was enacted. To implement his plan, Jehoiada calls in the military. Initially, he called in the commanders of the army units. Along with them, he sent for the Karaites, who seem to have been foreign mercenaries employed by the state of Israel, or Judah rather, and the temple guards. He swore them to secrecy, and then introduced them to this seven-year-old rightful king. And then he laid out the plan he'd come up with for the protection of the young Joash as he was presented to the people as their king. Well, the commanders all complied with the priest's orders. At the changing of the guards, when a military uprising would be more unlikely, the troops took up their positions. And Jehoiada brought Joash out to the people, put a crown on his head, gave him a copy of God's covenant with King David, and anointed him with oil. People were ecstatic, clapping their hands, blowing trumpets, shouting, "Long live the king!" And of course, Queen Athaliah heard the noise of this coronation celebration. And she comes out screaming, "Treason! Treason!" That's quite ironic, isn't it, really, for an illegitimate queen. It was far better than the others that had happened at that time. But that's how it happens. So the commanders all implement their orders. The queen panics. She has the person... Sorry, I lost my line there. So she comes out and shouts her words, "Treason, treason," and is promptly arrested, taken out, and met her end. And all the people go and take the temple of Baal and its altars and its priests, and they destroy them. Verse 20, all the people of the land rejoiced, and the city was calm because Athaliah had been slain with the sword at the palace, and Joash was 7 years old when he began to reign. Well, quite a chapter, eh? Quite a historical scene for us to read about, but let's ponder a couple of points that the chapter raises. And the first is this: God is never outwitted. As far as the events described in this chapter are concerned, God doesn't seem to be involved, does he? Oh, he's mentioned seven times in the phrase, the temple of the Lord. And once when we're told that Jehoiada made a covenant between the Lord and the king and the people. But he doesn't actually say anything in this chapter. Nor is there record of him doing anything. But that doesn't mean that God wasn't at work behind the scenes to guard his promise to King David. Now, of course, that's not the first time that sort of thing's happened, was it? Way back in the book of Exodus, God was going to raise up a man by the name of Moses to rescue his people from slavery in Egypt and lead them to the promised land. But when Moses was a baby, the king of Egypt got an attack of paranoia and ordered the Hebrew midwives to kill all Hebrew boy babies at birth. He then went further and ordered all his people to kill every Hebrew boy they came across by throwing him into the Nile. And to protect her baby from death, Moses' mother decided to get a papyrus basket, make it waterproof, and hide her infant among the reeds in the Nile River, would you believe? So along comes Pharaoh's daughter to bathe, comes across the basket, notes it contains a Hebrew baby. But as she's doing all of that, Moses' older sister comes out from her cover and asks if the princess would like someone to nurse the child. And it ends up, as many of you will know, with Moses' mother taking young Moses under her wing back home and getting paid to look after him until he's old enough to live in the palace of that murderous king as the son of the king's own daughter. You simply can't outwit God, can you? His intentions will happen, whatever the odds against them doing so might be. And when we come to the Son of David, our Lord Jesus Christ, there's another death threat, isn't there? From another paranoid king, Herod. This time, Magi from the east kind of messed things up by going to Herod's palace looking for the newborn king. Put the wind up, King Herod. And when he discovered a new king would be born in Bethlehem, he sent his troops there to kill all male children from 12 years old and under. And were it not for Joseph being supernaturally warned to get out of town at the double, the infant Jesus would have been one of those killed. But you can't outwit God. King Herod had no hope of achieving his evil intent, for God is greater than every tyrant who has stalked the earth. No more could Queen Athaliah keep God from keeping his word by killing off every possible king of David's line. God had his agents exactly where he wanted them and at the exact time needed. And they weren't the most well-known people in the history of the nation. Jehosheba, as mentioned, was only twice mentioned in the Bible here and the equivalent record in the second book of Chronicles. She isn't known for doing anything at all other than hiding the infant Joash. But my favorite writer of the Bible's historical books puts it like this. He says, "But isn't this the glory of God, that he does not need powerful or prominent people?" So we will be wrong, he says, if we get fixated on Jehosheba. We could too easily do that. Then we'd start marketing Jehosheba mugs and Jehosheba sweatshirts, and we'd try to get her on a Christian TV network. What is verse 2 saying? Its behind-the-scenes message is that nasty Athaliah didn't catch God on the back foot as she went on her murderous spree. He had just the servants he wanted in just the right place at the very time. Like Queen Esther, Jehosheba came to the kingdom for that exact time, for that exact purpose. The response being looked for from verse 2 is, praise God for that feisty lady. But it is all sola dea gloria, isn't it? To God alone be the glory. And it's there for our encouragement. It's there for days when God's cause seems to be under severe threat. And the gospel flame seems to be kind of flickering precariously across the land. Will godlessness ultimately win? No, it won't. And why won't it win? Is it because God building a people of power who are going to march through the land, driving out all opposition, as some used to mistakenly sing? No. He's more likely to rescue his cause by an unknown Jehoshaphat. For God doesn't share our droolings over celebrities. Paul had to remind those who loved status and popular applause at Corinth that God chose to build his church in that corrupt city, not through the influential elite. Those who were known at City Hall, those who were acclaimed in the public square. No, he deliberately chose the lowly things of this world, the despised, the things that are not, to nullify the things that are. Why? So that no one may boast before him. We have a message to proclaim that is not popular in our day, is it? It's about a person who is not popular. So if it's popularity we want, we've chosen the wrong side if we're following him. Jesus told his followers to expect trouble in this world, and that's mostly how it goes. The object of this chapter is not that we'll acclaim Jehoshaphat as our hero, but that we will worship the God of Jehoshaphat. For he has his servants exactly where he wants them today, for every eventuality. And they're not all famous people, are they, like Martin Luther? And that's an encouragement to you and me. They're the exception. Most are unknown Jehoshaphats who do their stuff and move off the scene unrecognized, unremembered. But they're there for the right time. But surely there's stuff to learn from Jehoshaphat and her husband Jehoiada, isn't there? They saw the challenge to God's promise of a king coming from David's line, and they did what they could. It was actually a risky thing they did, as it still is in many parts of our world. They took their lives in their hands to do what needed to be done for the sake of God's kingdom. Now ask yourself a question, as I asked myself a question. Where does that find you? Where does that find me? When it comes to the gospel and the church, am I a taker or am I a giver? And none of us can sit back and say, well, actually, I'm not gifted. Not in the light of what Jehoshaphat did. God isn't looking for heroes, for people who grab the headlines. He's looking for those who'll be concerned enough for his glory that they'll put themselves out to do whatever they can for his kingdom and praise. And God isn't a harsh employer, you know. He's not like the guy in the parable thought he was. But surely he must feel sadness, mustn't he? If we have room for pleasure, room for business, but none for serving Christ who gave himself for us. Mark records in his gospel narrative an incident where Jesus was taking time out in the home of Simon the leper. And while he was there, an unnamed woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume made of pure nard, and she broke the jar and poured the perfume on Jesus' head. Wow, did that cause consternation from some of those who were there. They thought it was a terrible waste, for the perfume could have been sold for more than a year's wages. But Jesus jumped to her defense, explaining what she'd done in these words. She did what she could. All right? That's all he's asking, isn't it, from you and me? That we'll do what we can. We're all gifted differently, aren't we? Some are good at cleaning premises. Some are good at putting up decorations. Some are good at welcoming people so that they feel at home when they come in. Some are techie, which sadly I'm not. But there are a variety of things that when we think about it, what could I do for the Lord Jesus? What could I do for the gospel? What could I do to help build the church? Might be you're good at catering for meals. You know, there are always something we can do for him. He himself gave the supreme example of doing what only he could, didn't he? You may well know John 3:16, but do you know 1 John 3:16? This is how it reads. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. So it's good to get to know each other, isn't it? Good to find friends within the church fellowship so that no one is left on their own. You know, you may have a telephone or a mobile, and well, you could phone someone who's lonely, couldn't you? Encourage them, cheer them, pop round, visit them. There are needs that God can bring us along to meet. He raised up Jehoshaphat, that lady, for that moment. Perhaps you're the only Christian where you work. Perhaps the Lord Jesus isn't getting a fair hearing there. Is there an opportunity to be a Jehoshaphat at work? It'd be great to meet the Lord Jesus, wouldn't it? With some, wouldn't be able to say, did that for you. Did it for your glory. And receive his praise. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into your master's joy. Well, there then is Jehoshaphat. You see, if Queen Athaliah had had her way, if Jehoshaphat had not stepped in at huge risk to herself, there would have been no angels singing glory to God in the highest, would there? There would have been no shepherds hearing the good news of great joy that a baby just born was their saviour, Christ the Lord. There would have been no magi coming from afar to worship the real king, because there would have been no son of David. For David's line would have been wiped out. There would have been no sacrifice for sins, no glorious rising from the grave, no forgiveness or eternal life for returning penitents. So we ought to thank God, didn't we? For the lady who saved Christmas. And perhaps learn from her what the Lord would have us do with our lives at this moment. Let's pray. God and Father, thank you that you are all-knowing. Thank you that you are all-powerful. Thank you that you are in charge. Thank you that nobody on earth or in hell can stop you bringing your plans about. And thank you that in order to enact them, you often use ordinary people like us. Thank you for that. Thank you for the privilege of being able to serve you with whatever you give us. Help us to use what's our time, our talent, our money, whatever it is, Lord, help us to use it for your glory, for the good of your people, for the saving of those who are lost. We bring ourselves to you. Speak to us, we pray, and may your Holy Spirit be our helper to live the life that honours you. As we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing another hymn before we share in the Lord's Supper. I cannot tell why he whom angels worship should set his love upon the sons of men.